wanted to give a few shout-outs before we get into our message, because I am a true believer that you can never say thank you too much. And so I just wanted to introduce our worship leader. This is Chelsea. Isn't she amazing? And this could, you know, go on and on and on about how we connected and how she's with us, but we'll save that story for another time. But I just want to tell you that being here has God's fingerprint all over it, and just a little bit about her, just so you get to know our team. Chelsea works with people who were trafficking victims and domestic violence victims, and she works at a nonprofit, and she also just has such a pure heart of worship, and she's from Hawaii, and she's been here for the past 10 years, and we're just so blessed to have her with us. So thank you so much, Chelsea, for being with us. I also wanted to introduce some other people on the stage. This is Daryl, and this is Jeffrey, and if you look toward their back, our drummer was my husband, Derek, and then we have Evan and Bob back there, too. And one thing I want to just point out, apologies for the co-presenter that keeps flashing up on the screen. Our church recently put in a new computer and then had to exchange it, so there's just a little technical difficulty, so it's not Evan's fault at all. Just want to point that out there. But really, thank you, AV team. We can't do services without our AV team. And I also just wanted to say a few thank yous to our core team. And so the past year and few months, it's just been the most awesome thing to be able to start from a ministry called Kingdom Overflow in 2018-2019, and then that dream become a reality of being a service, which is Revive. And I have my Revive core team with me, and so we have Michael here, so say hi to Michael. And then we have Lynn Ogawa and Karina Ogawa, and then Derek Wong. And so just wanted to say thank you to them, because they make this show go on, and I'm just so thankful for just their hearts and helping in creating the content and creating everything else. So just wanted to say thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you to our greeting team, to our prayer team, to our worship AV team, and thank you to all of you who are here with us. And even though I'm carving out a little bit of time to just say thank you, I just wanted to say that up top because I think it's really important. So thank you, guys. And as I go into just our message portion, I just wanted to introduce myself. Hi, my name is Lauren Fukuzawa Wong, and I'm one of the associate pastors here at Anaheim. And I'm also the pastoral oversight for Revive. And this is a huge part of my heart, this huge part of what God put on my heart. And we're so, so happy that you are here to join us today. As I said, before I started worship, we're all about authenticity, intentionality, belonging, and freedom. And we want to facilitate spaces like that so we're able to just come as we are and come as just a child of God, as they were singing. And in this place, I just want to share where we've come from. And so if you take a look at this large frame here, this is actually, oh, this is Prayers for Revive, and this started so long ago, and we had several leaders' meetings where people just brought together prayers and words and pictures of what they felt that this service could be. And a lot of our core values came from this, a lot of our, even our big verse that I read came from this, and it's just been a really neat thing to know that this service is founded on prayers. It's not founded on, our fleshly thoughts and wants, but it's really founded upon prayer and where God has brought us. And so I just want to point that out. And then I wanted to share one picture as well that came from our last leaders meeting. And I just got this picture of God bringing heaven and earth together. And it was kind of this picture of the sky kind of touching the ground, and I felt that that was God's hope for us, that we can facilitate a space to bring heaven to earth with our worship, with our authenticity, with the sense of coming together for healing and freedom on behalf of His name. I just wanted to also share where we've come from just through the pandemic. So we launched on January 26th, 2020, then we had 6 in-person meetings, and then the pandemic hit. And then we, you know, gracefully pivoted and figured out what we wanted to do, what we wanted it to look like. And we created this online community. And so, you know, our videos are up on YouTube, but we've had 39 devotionals and 32 online meetings that almost acted like small groups. And it created this really intimate space of just really genuine sharing, which was really awesome. We also launched a blog called Reviving Beauty from Ashes, where we just put reflections of who God is in our lives and how He's been speaking to us. And then here we are today. And so we're going to continue this hybrid online in person. So we have calendars in the narthex, and hope you can pick one up when you leave. But we're going to have one in person and one online every month until our 2-year anniversary, which is in January. And then we'll start all in person in February. But we really just wanted to honor the space that God has been bringing us in with being able to worship in corporate worship, and then also an act of worship of just sharing together in our online space. And so with that, that's where we've come from. That's how God brought us here. And as we go into just the heart of the message, Michael and I are going to be team teaching and sharing today. But I was asking God, what do you want us to talk about? What do you want us to share? There's so much that we can say, because, you know, you could talk about God just all the time because He's just so good. But as I was at my laptop this week, and as I was typing, usually my rhythm is I'll type out some notes and then I'll type out a manuscript, and then that becomes a message. But something kind of different happened this week, and I was typing things out, and it didn't look like notes, and it didn't look like a manuscript. So at first I was a little confused, but it came out in the form of a poem or like a spoken word, and I was kind of shocked because I've never really done that before. Maybe, you know, years and years ago, but I've never shared any of them with anyone. And so as I was typing out, I was just fearful, because I was like, wow, when people share spoken words, they feel really vulnerable. And I never, ever, ever thought that I would do that. And so the fact that that's what God wanted me to have on paper and share with you today, I was kind of just shocked, and I was kind of in fear, because it's almost like you ripping off my flesh and like seeing my heart and it just being exposed. And that's kind of scary. But as, you know, Chelsea was thinking, like, we're no longer slaves to fear. We're a child of God. And I was just thinking, like, oh man, okay, I think that's the courage and that's the word that I needed for today. That whatever I could say or whatever I could do, and whatever you could say or whatever you can do, like, there's nothing that could take away from our identity in being a child of God. And so I hope we could all just embrace that today, and I'm going to read this poem or spoken word that I felt like God put on my heart, and I think it sort of encompasses the past 522 days in navigating the pandemic, and yeah, I really felt that God's heart is for the broken, God's heart is for the weary, God's heart is to comfort those in mourning. And God's heart is for us to know that we are children of God. Okay, so I'm going to read this poem or spoken word that God put on my heart this past week. And I kind of want to just do an exercise. If we could just kind of close our eyes while I read this. And as we close our eyes, if we could imagine these things that I'm saying, maybe we can imagine these people that I'm going to bring up. And I want you to posture your hearts and your minds and not seeing these people how you see them, with whatever political background or whatever denominational background. But I want you to see and envision all that I'm about to read through God's eyes and through His lens. So it's not our lens, but it's His lens. Okay. So this is titled, His Children Are Hurting, His Children Are Broken. COVID, conspiracies, masked and unmasked. How do we cope in a world that is fallen? His children are hurting, His children are broken. Democrats, Republicans, BLM, Make America Great Again. How do we heal in a world that's divided so thin? His children are hurting, His children are broken. Straight, gay, LGBT, he, she, them, they, imago, day. How do we claim to love amidst not attempting to stand in? His children are hurting, His children are broken. Triggering, canceling, trigger pulling, and deception. How do we bring peace to something that's so far from His intentions? His children are hurting, His children are broken. Empathy, truth, church, and deconstruction. How do we bridge gaps when we cannot even listen? His children are hurting, His children are broken. Restoration and unity, belonging, and true freedom. With many questions left unanswered, there's intentional work to be done. His children are hurting, His children are broken. And as you continue to just soak those words, those types of people, those identities, in your head, in your heart, in your mind, and you see them not through your eyes or your beliefs or your identities, but you see them through God's eyes. I almost want us to put on some spiritual contacts so that when we walk out of these doors, we wouldn't feel hatred, or we wouldn't feel brokenness. We wouldn't feel things that are of this world. But we could lean in to God's eyes. We could lean into God's heart. Okay, now we can open our eyes again. So thank you for just listening to that as part of my heart, just being exposed. Fun fact, I asked you to close your eyes so you wouldn't be looking at me when I was reading it. But also, I just really wanted you to picture things in God's eyes, in God's lens. And in transition, I wanted us to just think about what it looks like to be a child of God. And we're going to be launching a new series, and it's going to be called Becoming Our True Selves. And it's going to be based off of the book of Ephesians. And in this book, Paul has this radical message on it not being just for the Jews, but for being for Jews and Gentiles. And so when Chelsea was like singing that, right? It's Jews, Gentiles, it's all of us. It's for children of God. That just gave me like the heebie-jeebies on my arm. I was like, oh God, that's so your message. It's for everyone. Your message of love is for everyone. And becoming our true selves, realizing God's love for us is for everyone. And so with that, with knowing that Paul's radical mission was to know that God's love and God's story is for everyone. I'm going to bring up Michael Ono, and he's going to be kicking off our series on Ephesians and becoming our true selves.
It is good to see everyone, and I was getting honestly kind of emotional, like looking around during worship. So many of you, most of you really, are people that have been very pivotal in my life, and you all feel like family to me, and so it is an honor and a privilege to be able to be here, to be able to be sharing with you today in the midst of family together. And thank you so much, Lauren, for sharing your heart and sharing that spoken word with us. We'll definitely come back to that in a little bit. But as Lauren was saying, we are starting a new series that we'll be journeying through over really the rest of the year. Through the book of Ephesians. And many of you probably know this, the book of Ephesians is actually a letter. It's a letter from one of the early Christian leaders, Paul. And he was writing to a community, or it could possibly have been a network of communities around the region of Ephesus. And they were trying to figure out what their lives were going to look like, how to live in the aftermath of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And so I think it's fitting for us to be going through Ephesians right now, because in so many ways I think we're still figuring out what we want our lives to be about, what we want life to look like, and what life is supposed to look like. Not just right now, just in general, but you know, think about the past year and just how much has changed, how much we've changed from a year and a half ago. I know for some of us, this might be the first time we're in a church since the pandemic started. And so we're figuring things out just like the communities were in Ephesus. Now, what's really neat about the letter to the Ephesians, though, is it's a letter, and it's specific. It's written by a real person to real people at a real point in time. And yet, there are these huge, grand truths that the book conveys to us. Things that are foundational to our faith. And so, I want to share briefly about what even the structure of the book is like. Because it's really genius, actually. So the way that the letter is structured, so again, it's Paul writing to groups of Christians, and the first half of the book, so we could go to the next slide, the first half of the book, chapters 1 through 3, is just a series of declarations and describing who we are and what we have in God. That's it. That's the whole first half of the book, who we are and what we have in God. Then the second half of the book, chapters 4 through 6, the next slide, that's then how do we live in response as a result of knowing who we are and what we have in God. And the order here matters. Now, in the first half of the letter, there's only one command. There's only one command, and it's to remember. Remember who we are and what we have in God, what God has done for us. And then the second half is then, that's the more practical application. What does that mean for our lives? And the order matters, because what this book teaches us, we can go to the next slide of the text, is that the foundation of our faith, the foundation of our spiritual walk, is to be grounded in who we are in God. That's the foundation of everything. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. And so I'm actually just going to read the first few verses, like literally just four verses in Ephesians. And actually, my Bible is small text. I'm just going to read it off of the screen. And what we're going to read is this grand image that Paul gives of what life in God is like. So let me just read this for us. Paul opens the letter by saying, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed upon us in the beloved." Now that is a mouthful. There's a lot there, and it's kind of overwhelming almost. So if we go to the next slide, I think I highlighted some of the words. I truly just want to key in on some of these key ideas of what Paul is saying here. He is making these grand claims about what our lives are like in God. He says that we are blessed. He says that we are chosen. He says that we are holy and blameless. He says that we are adopted as God's children. Now, those are really big ideas, but I would just boil it down. One of my favorite authors is this Christian writer named Henry Nouwen, and one of his books is my favorite book I have here. It's called Life of the Beloved. And essentially, he boils down this truth to this, that our identity in God is that we are God's beloved. That's the core of everything. That is the meaning behind what we are reading here, that we are blessed, chosen, holy, blameless, part of God's family. All comes down to this idea that we are loved fully and deeply. We are known and we are valued by God. And again, notice there's no commandments here. There's nothing about you need to do this, you need to say this. This is what's true about who you are. Can we go to the next few slides? So I've listed here some of the core ideas, and then again, we could spend a long time going through all of them, but I just wanted to narrow it down to these four. So first, it says that we are blessed. Second, that we are chosen. Third, that we are blameless, holy and blameless. And fourth, that we are part of God's family. Now, the radical nature, and Lauren and Chelsea both mentioned this, is that Paul is talking, we know this from later in the letter, he addresses Jews and Gentiles, Jews and non-Jews. And the crazy thing is that each of these claims is something that would have been in the Old Testament about Israel. That Israel is blessed, Israel is chosen, Israel is a holy nation, Israel is God's children. And Paul is now saying, this is true of all of you. Jews, Gentiles, husbands, wives, parents, children, masters, and slaves, all these different groups, this is what's true of you. And it's what's true of us. No matter who you are, what your age or gender or ethnicity or political affiliation or sexual orientation, whether you grew up in church or this is the first time you've been in church, this is the reality of how God views his children. Now, that's all nice and awesome to hear. But if you're like me, it can be easy to kind of gloss over what this is saying. One, because we've heard it before. But two, because if we're honest, it really doesn't feel like this matches up to our lived experience, to what we encounter in our everyday lives. And it comes back to what Lauren was sharing about in the poem that she wrote. All of the ways that humanity is hurting, broken, weary. So much of that is what we encounter in our everyday lives. And so I have another slide, the next one. As if this is what's true about our lives in God, what is actually our lived experience? What does that look like? Maybe instead of blessed, it feels like we're cursed. And what I mean by that is there may be some of us who feel like life is just against us, that nothing we do is going right, and that maybe all of our time and energy is spent trying to just survive, just make it, just get through the day. Maybe that's the reality that feels true to us. Or instead of chosen, maybe what we feel is unwanted, and that all of our time and energy is spent trying to earn the approval, earn the appeal of other people. And maybe instead of blameless, what we feel is guilt and shame, haunted by our past, about what we did or didn't do or thought we should have done better. And maybe instead of understanding that we are part of God's family, what we really feel is we feel alone. And we spend our time and our energy trying to find that person, that place, that group where I feel like I belong. And so when we look at these two lists together, we're confronted with this paradox that we are both already the truths that are spoken over us, that we are right now blessed, chosen, holy, blameless, in the community and family of God. And yet, there is so much that we experience in our everyday lives that is counter to what is being said that is true of us. And so we live in this tension of being the beloved, but also needing to become the beloved and experience all that is true of us, but in our real everyday lives. Henry Nouwen, I'm going to go back to Henry because I like him. He puts it this way. If we can go to the next slide. From the moment we claim the truth of being the beloved, we are faced with the call to become who we are. That we both are the beloved, and it is the person that we are becoming as we choose to fully embrace and say yes to what is true about our deepest core, our essence, how God really sees us. And I understand that that even this might be hard to wrap our heads around. And it's because I think, you know, when we face and encounter repeated experiences of feeling pain, of suffering, of failure, of rejection, when those things happen over and over again, our minds become trained to think about, to see that as the lens that we view life. A couple of years ago in 2018, that was me. I was going through kind of a hard time myself. This is a good thing, but I recently got promoted to a new managerial role at my work. But man, I was feeling the pressure of it, and I felt like I really wasn't doing a good job at it. And I think work was part of it, and I think there were other things contributing, but it really led to this point that I was feeling a constant level of stress, anxiety, and pressure on my shoulders day in and day out. I would be waking up with kind of a feeling of dread of having to get up and go to work. And, you know, I didn't end up going to see a therapist or a counselor or anything, but I wouldn't have been surprised if you know, they would have come back and said, oh, I think maybe you're going through a mild form of depression or anxiety. But for me, I kind of wrote it off as, well, you know what, maybe that's just what adult life is like. maybe it's just hard. And maybe I just need to suck it up, and this is what life is like now. And then that summer, we went to our family camp, church camp, and I was one of the leaders of the college program, and so our college speaker that year, he took us through the book of Ephesians. And he walked us through these claims, these grand claims about who we are in God, our identity. And throughout the week, we were challenged and invited to think about how can we make and embrace these truths in our lives. And for me, I hadn't been one to really voice all that the anxiety and stress that I was feeling. But at the end of the week, we decided to, as a group, come up and one, name and reject the ways that maybe we would have been living with the lens of that lie about what life is like, who we are, and to instead embrace the truth about what God is saying through the book of Ephesians. And so for me, I felt like I had to go first. And so I said, you know, I name and I reject that I am a slave to anxiety and stress and pressure. And that I believe and I declare that I am blessed in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. And things didn't change instantaneously. But I look back at that night and I think that was a spark in my life, a spark of hope, a spark of courage, and a spark into freedom to start setting my eyes on the spiritual journey of claiming the truth of who I really am and not be defined by the life circumstances that I was going through at the moment. And that is the great task. That is the spiritual journey that is before all of us, is to claim the truth of who we are, and to embrace it and allow it to be the ground on which we stand and the center from which we live. Now, I don't know where everyone here is at, whether you're kind of further along in the journey in claiming that truth in your life, or maybe you could be like how I was a couple years ago, feeling stuck. You know, when we look back at everything that is going on right now, there is so much in life that we can choose to focus on about the suffering, the hardship, the rejection. It can feel like this mountain that is impossible to climb. But today, and as we continue on through our journey through Ephesians, I want to invite us to think about what is the truth that God wants to share with us, the truth that he wants us to claim about who we are in him. And as we choose to go down this path, this journey of claiming the truth of who we are, that God himself would come and transform us from the inside out. I'm going to invite the worship team back up. We are going to spend a little bit more time in musical worship. And we're going to spend some time in reflection as well. And so especially as we spend the next couple of minutes in worship, I want to invite us to be thinking about those questions. What is the truth of who we are that God would want us to claim in our lives? What is his heart for us today and as we continue forward? Pray for us real quick. Heavenly Father, we praise your name for the ways that you declare that we are your lay down the ways that we may have put limits and bounds on your love? The ways that it may be hard for us to open ourselves up, to really believe what is true of us, to believe what you say we are. And so, Lord Jesus, I ask that in your name that there would be those blockages that would prevent us from experiencing that and knowing that in the depth of our heart and soul, that those would be gone, and that you would open us up to experiencing the fullness and depth of your love for us. And may that be the place that is the foundation for everything, the place that we live from, the ground on which we stand. So let's take just a moment here as we enter into worship and invite the Lord into this space. Thank you.
so we believe that God is a relational God. He wants to be with us, and He wants to speak to us. And so I just felt it on my heart right now that everyone here is coming from a different season, maybe a different place in life. Maybe some of us are really struggling, and maybe some of us are actually doing really great. And I feel like what God wants to say to each one of us is that He wants to meet you where you are, and He just wants to be with you. And so whatever you are seeking today, whether it's joy, whether it's peace, love, hope, Jesus says, I am the answer. And so I just want to take a moment right now, and if you feel like you are seeking something and that you want to hear from God, just go ahead and open your arms or pull out your hands, maybe place it on your heart, just a gesture to show, like, here I am, God, and I want more of you, I want to hear from you. And so I just want to pray for us right now. So Father, I just want to lift up each person here, Lord, that we are seeking your heart, we are open, we want more of you. And so Father, I just pray each person right now who is hungry for you, that you will just meet them and meet their need wherever they are at. And so Father, I just release peace over each person here in the name of Jesus. Lord, I just pray for a restoration of hope in your name. And Lord, I just pray that each person here can feel seen and loved by you immensely. And so, Father, I just thank you for how you've created each person here so beautifully and so uniquely. And today, may they just feel a shift within their mind, body, and soul that they are seen and loved by you. So, Lord, I just want to pray this in your name, God. Amen. And so if you would like to receive more prayer and just an encouraging word, our prayer team will be in the back to just pray for you. And we can take you outside, whatever you are comfortable with. The opportunity is there for you.
Love has ravished my heart.
embracing our truths and laying the lies at the foot of the cross. So right now, as you receive the benediction, I pray that you could imagine yourself laying your fears, laying the lies before Jesus right now, before his cross, before his feet. And you could take on his incredible, unconditional, undying love. And whatever other truth he has for you on this day. So may you embrace his truths. May you embrace his love, and may you walk in a place that you can truly say, I am being my true self, where God has created me and called me to be. And we close and seal this time in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen, amen. Thank you so much for joining us here at our first relaunch of Revive. We can't wait to see you next time. And just a quick announcement, our next Revive Online will be August 25th on Saturday at 2 p.m. And our next in-person in the chapel is going to be Sunday, September 19th at 4 p.m. So thank you so much for joining us here today. Feel free to hang out and just socialize for a little bit, but we're so glad to have you here. God bless. And